Hi! Today we're talking about overlooked cards in Commander. I'm Zach.
I'm Nick.
I'm Austin.
I'm Jason.
And this is Velvet Games. So this one comes as a bit of a request from one of our friends and friends of the channel, Tony.
I see you, Tony.
We see you, Tony.
We know where you live.
I know exactly where
I've actually
you live.
Been to his house.
There you go.
I've been in his room. Anyway.
Okay.
This is a topic that I kind of really like, too, because I think that there are plenty of cards out there that really just don't see a lot of play, or maybe they do see some degree of play, but they're just like they're kind of overlooked for other cards, maybe because they do it better or just doesn't really fit the deck, but whatever the reason. Mm-hmm. This one's for all the left out cards.
All the underdog cards.
Yeah, all the underdog cards. Yeah. The cards that are do a good job.
All the cards that get picked last on the team.
Yeah. This one's for them.
This one's for the last picks.
Is Sol Ring.
I don't know about last pick, but
let's do study. Oh my gosh. No one ever plays it.
No one plays it.
Oh no.
What does that card do?
I don't know.
So my first pitch. Well, mind you, I'm kind of doing this like least to best.
Right.
Least to best, yeah, okay.
Yeah, like in terms of my favorites. All right. None of these are like the best card or whatever. It's just kind of like personal opinion and stuff.
Yeah.
Like So my third pick, I should say, is Gaia's Blessing. Probably a card that does get a lot of play somewhere. I don't really see a lot of the people in our play group sort of play it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm probably the one who plays it the most.
You definitely do.
I have some, but you definitely play it.
Yeah, I think I definitely have, I think, a deck. Out of all the green decks I have, I think I have a deck that runs Gaia's. But
and see, and this is a card that I humbly feel should be in every green deck.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
In fact, every copy that I have is in a deck. It's a sorcery speed, but target player shuffles up to 3 target cards from their graveyard into their library.
Mm-hmm.
Grave Recursion for you, messes up your enemy opponent's plan if they have like a dredge deck or whatever.
Right.
That's true, yeah.
But it also, you can draw a card. So, I mean, for just 2 mana, you're getting Grave Recursion and drawing a card.
Yeah, which is pretty good.
Stopping mill.
The best part, yeah, I was going to say the best part about this card, though, when Gaia's Blessing is put into your graveyard from your library, shuffle your graveyard into your library.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Anti-mill.
Exactly.
Okay, I like that.
It's a nice little, it's extra Grave Recursion whenever it just plops in.
Yeah, when somebody decides to, you know, turn that 72-72 consuming aberration sideways because they have Phoenix out, and you're like, oh, cool.
And that's the thing. Whenever Austin plays a mill deck,
we don't talk about it.
I just immediately grab a green deck because I know I've got one of these in there. I know I'm going to be okay. Maybe not survive, but have a better chance of doing so.
Yeah, yeah. Zach preemptively plans if he sees me put CDC down on the board.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I also run in Targnar, too, for the Gaia's Blessing and Turn the Earth.
Yep.
So, like, it's the combo that's, like, one green if Gaia's Blessing is somehow, like, gone to the graveyard somehow. Because it goes if you cast it,
mm-hmm.
and then it doesn't shuffle, but you put it back in. And then you're like, cool, it's back in my library now. Oh, you're going to mill me out? Well, nice try.
Yeah, that's okay. I like that. Saucy. Yep. I definitely am a fan of that. Okay. So I guess I'll get into mine now. This is also kind of a card I don't really see a lot of people use. I know a good number of token players, not just our star token player here, but I know a good number of other token players across... I know a good number of other token players who make, you know, token decks typically with a splash of white or white being the main focus. This is a card that I don't really get see ran in a lot of token decks. I think it kind of should. So the card is Leyline of the Meek. It is 2 and double white, so a 4 mana enchantment. It has the clause of text that the other ley lines have that says if this is in your opening hand, you may begin the game with it on your battlefield. All it does is creature tokens get +1/+1. And my big thing with why I think more people should be running it, especially in token decks, is because a lot of people kind of overlook it because of the other cards like Intangible Virtue.
Sure.
Or, you know, like Glorious Anthem is the immediate one people mm-hmm. go to because it's like all creatures get +1/+1. So, okay, cool. Wouldn't you want more of that in your token deck? And in comparison to some of the other Lord Anthem effects in enchantments, it's not the worst. I mean, sure, yeah, it's going to feel a little bad to hard cast it for 4 mana, but people hard cast Leyline of the Void. People hard cast Leyline Anticipation.
Yeah,
sure.
People hard cast that one green Leyline that says you make an additional green whenever you make green mana. I don't remember what it's called.
Leyline of Abundance.
Yeah, Leyline of Abundance, yes. But people usually hard cast the ley lines. They're not the worst thing in the world. They just have that little extra sweet caveat of like, oh, hey, did you start your hand and you only have 3 lands, but this is in your hand?
Yeah.
You just get to immediately start with it on the board. Now you're down one less card. So in the event you don't hit that fourth land in the first two turns or whatever, you're not going to have to worry about having to dump cards straight into the graveyard.
Sure.
Right.
I think it's neat. I think it kind of helps supplement into the whole, like, if you want things that bolster your tokens, you want more of that in mm-hmm. the deck.
Yeah.
I personally run this in my Gear-Ed deck because Gear-Ed spits out a ton of tokens really quickly. I have, obviously, like, Intangible Virtue and other things that buff my tokens, but I kind of want that little bit extra. That plus one could make all the difference when you're swinging in with 14 4/4 rhinos mm-hmm. that are now 5/5 or 7/7 rhinos with trample, or, sure. you know, your 16 4/4 angels with flying that now are 6/6 angels with flying because of Intangible Virtue in this.
Yeah.
That extra plus one can make all the difference in the token decks like that. I think more people should be at least considering putting it in the deck.
Understandable.
This conversation makes me very happy. Speaking of tokens. So mine is very simple. It is a card called Last Ditch Effort. It is one red for an instant that says sacrifice X creatures. Last Ditch Effort deals X damage to target creature or player. So I have played this in a few of my decks, but unfortunately, I can't remember if it's expensive or not, but like there's a reason I just don't have too many of them. So like when I make a new token deck with red in it, I normally just swap it out. So I don't know if it's just whatever, but like anyway, the decks I do run it in, I have straight up just killed people in response because they're just like, oh, I'm gonna board wipe, and it's like, okay, cool, well, you're already gonna blow up board, so I'm just gonna sacrifice 40 creatures and you die, or hey, I'm gonna Thassa's Oracle in response, sacrifice 40 creatures, you die.
Yeah, that's
or, like, yeah, no, it's kind of funny. Yeah, I think a lot of people kind of draw the comparison for it with like Goblin Bombardment, but I think this is a little better because Goblin Bombardment is just like you have to do like separate triggers with mm-hmm. it. This is all at once. So you don't have to worry about like them being like, oh, well, in response to you trying to sacrifice it, I'm going to exile or whatever. This is like, nope, I'm doing it all at once.
Yep.
It's kind of neat. I like that. And for
it's
one red mana.
It's part of the cost, too, so they can't get rid of it.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. It's kind of nice. But for one red.
I didn't know that card exists.
So, really?
Yeah. I'm going to put that in my Rocko deck
mm-hmm.
where I make infinite tokens and just be like, yep. And die.
And you're dead.
I will say, with your strategy, though, you do have to be careful with it.
Oh, I know. This isn't, like, this isn't
people,
great.
If you kill the person board wiping, and then it's like the board wipe goes away, so you just wiped out your board.
Right, but like I'm just saying.
True,
The issue with that is, right, if they board wipe, they're going to wipe everything anyway. So, like, sure, and mind you, with that, that is a very much a, you know, I'm going to get rid of you before all these go away, but everyone does get to keep their stuff, like you're saying.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
But
on top of that,
it depends.
Austin playing that might not initially draw all the enmity from the other two players mm-hmm. because then they'd be like, oh, well, he just wiped out his
He's
whole
now
board
useless.
To take out one person.
Fair, you could also just be like, do a threat assessment, and mm-hmm. if wiping out the board doesn't affect one of the players, you're just like, cool, die.
Yeah.
Cool. In response, die.
Yeah. It's a very, it's just a versatile card.
Yeah, it's neat. Like this is definitely a card I don't think I've. Not even with you, I don't think. I don't think I've ever seen you play this or really anyone else ever.
See, okay, so Zach said the same thing.
Yeah, like, I was like, what red deck did you ever play
this? It's literally in my Jemir deck right now, and then it's also, I believe I have two copies, and the other one's in my Shadow Gang Bros.
Jemir goes in, though.
Austin's the overlooked poser. He just acts like his cards are overlooked.
I was playing overlooked cards before they were even considered
before
overlooked.
Before they were overlooked.
Like, yeah,
let's
just
totally
in my deck.
Yeah. By the way, Last Ditch Effort is 95 cents.
Okay, we'll see. That's, I need to buy more.
Yeah, we can go buy more right now.
That's
check out our sponsors at whatever card
this episode.
Whatever card place wants to sponsor us.
Please, we're begging you.
We need to eat.
All right, Jason, all right, let's
similar
see
to Zach's Guy's Blessing, I think this is a black staple card that I don't see a whole lot of people running. And when I do run it, people are like, oh, I've never seen that card before. I'm like, how? So it's Morbid Opportunist, 2 and a black. It's a creature that's 1/3. It says whenever one or more creatures die, draw a card. This ability only triggers once each turn. So, like, name me a black deck that doesn't kill a creature every once in a while.
Right.
Name me a commander circumstance where you're not seeing a creature die almost every turn.
That's like most commander games, if not every commander
there are,
game.
There are all those times, but I mean, it depends.
There's those rare times where it's like a family, you know, what do they call it? Fair Magic.
Yeah,
when
fair
nobody's
magic.
Doing anything.
Oh, yeah, I was just saying, well, you're all doing Expel Slinger type decks.
No one's playing turn one Forest into Sol Ring into Arcane Signet. You know, fair magic.
Right. Exactly. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But with Morbid Opportunist, like, you kind of, okay, yeah, you could kill all these creatures, but I'll just draw a card, and I'll draw a card. And it's only once per turn, so it's not overpowered by any means.
Right. It doesn't get busted.
It's not a Harvester of Souls that's, like, whenever creature dies, draw a card.
Yeah,
and
that's
true. And
it
just keeps going. But it's only 3 mana, too. And it's a 1/3, so the chances of it dying on turn 3 is a little bit less likely.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
So I just think this is it should be a black staple card.
Yeah.
Where it's just easily like, okay, I'm playing a sacrifice deck. This mm-hmm. needs to go in it. I'm playing a kill your stuff deck. This needs to go in it. I'm playing a rat calling you deck. Yeah, maybe this doesn't go in it, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, but yeah, you consider it.
Yeah.
And it's funny, too, because this is a more recent card. This came out in Midnight Hunt, didn't it? Yeah. And like kind of you were saying, I've seen it played a couple times, but I don't see it get played, especially like in aristocrat decks, especially.
Yeah.
You would think this would be in the 99 easily. But out of all the people that we play with who have aristocrat decks, I don't think I see very many of them run this card, and it's a little strange.
To be fair, there may be better options.
Yeah.
No, I 100% believe that.
You know, there are cards where you sack to them to draw cards.
Sure.
Or,
right.
I think the one downside is a lot of them aren't maze.
Yeah.
And they trigger every death.
Right.
Yeah.
So, like, somebody blows up the board, and it's just like, well, I'm dead because I just lost. I just drew my deck, right? You know, or like,
yeah,
you know, the ones where it's like a murderous rider. No, not murderous rider. What's the one I'm thinking of? It's like the knights,
Sir Conrad.
Yeah,
Sir Conrad. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's like, oh, I just suddenly lost a bunch of life.
Yeah.
Yikes! Yeah, it gets kind of bad. Yeah, and some of those, like you were saying, some of those are not May abilities. You have to do it. It's like, oh, so the token player had how many creatures? And I have to draw that many cards?
Right.
Oh, well, I'm out of the game now.
I definitely think that's a nice alternative to those, though. And if you're trying to do a deck that's very, like, high risk and you don't want to, like...
Yeah.
Well, it's not a May, though, to draw it, but it is only once per turn.
Right. Yeah, it does only trigger. Well, it only triggers once, which is also kind of nice because it kind of feels not as, like, busted. As some of the other card draw effects in black that are kind of just like, draw and draw and draw.
Yeah, and that's the thing, too. I think it takes the heat off of you.
Yeah,
because people are like, oh, only once
it's
per
limited.
Turn.
You're right.
Yeah, okay. No, 100%.
Nobody's taking the kill spell for that. You know.
Wow.
Yeah. nobody's blowing it for that.
Check out our what not to do's to see what people have done.
Yeah.
That they
ooh. Oh boy. So, spicy stuff.
All right. So my number two is a very fun card. It's a Warp World. It's
the funnest.
Mana red sorcery. A lot of words here. Bear with me. Each player shuffles all permanents he or she owns into his or her library, then reveals that many cards from the top of his or her library. Each player puts all artifact, creature, and lands revealed this way on the battlefield, then does the same for enchantment cards, then puts all cards revealed this way that weren't put onto the battlefield on the bottom of his or her library. So basically, affects everybody. Everybody basically counts up all the permanents they have, chucks them back into their library, shuffle around, and then just flip off the top, and let's see what we get.
Yep.
It's pure chaos. I don't remember who showed me this card first.
I think it was Keaton.
I want to say it was Keaton or Billy.
Yeah, it sounds like Keaton or Billy.
It sounds like one of those two. So
I want to say it was Keaton, but it may have been
Keaton. Showed me the card, and now I use the card like it's wildfire.
Yeah, it's funny. It's funny because Zach showed me this card, like I think like a long while back, and it's the reason why I run it in my Vazi deck. Cause it's like, everybody's kind of getting way ahead of me. Cool, we're
like,
resetting.
From the first time I saw this card, like when we started playing Magic, I was like, that is such a cool card. I need that. Like,
this is dumb. I love it.
It's in my Chaos deck, for a good reason.
Right.
I have a black red Chaos deck.
Does the Scorpion God deck?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And, I've actually killed myself with this card before.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
I can understand that.
So I shuffled all my permanents back into my library, flipped off the top, got an Inverter of Truth.
Oh.
Oh no.
My library is now gone. My graveyard's now my library. I have like 5 cards in my library. Let's go.
How many cards are in your graveyard, Zach? 5. How many turns do you have, Zach? 5.
But it's fun. I mean, it's a nice, fun little chaosy card.
Yeah.
It's nice. And it's also a nice board clear in some circumstances.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
I wouldn't say if you're targeting somebody who's got like a lot on their board,
somebody
who's got powerful stuff on their board, it's like, all right, let's get rid of that and see what else we can get.
Yeah.
It also destroys Spell Slinger decks.
It does. Yeah. It horribly messes
because
up Spell
Slinger
decks.
If you've got nothing that are permanents, it's like, oh, I just get
Events.
Exactly.
It also can be, depending, it can be a little disadvantageous to token decks because the tokens are still permanents.
Yep.
So if they have more tokens than they do cards in their library, that could be really bad for them.
I'm
going to
argue the opposite, right? Mm-hmm. You play this in a token deck where you've got a full setup, and you play this, you now have every permanent in your library on the field.
Correct.
If you can't win in that situation, you got a bad. If you have your entire deck on the field and you can't win, you built a bad deck.
That's very true.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you can't win.
I agree with that.
You are.
I agree to an extent, because if you can't, you have the chance of, like, if that's all your whole deck is on the field, you have to draw or you lose.
You know what I'm saying? Because obviously, you have some instants and sorceries.
Sure.
Oh yeah, no, for sure.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, you know, when you cast this and you have, like, a like, if you're dumping most of your deck on the field,
right?
You know, and you still have some left.
Yeah.
You can't win in that situation.
Not only that, but it is red. You should have something that, like, gives all your permanents haste or gives all your creatures haste or something like that.
Does it say that lands come in tapped or anything?
Nope.
No, I think the lands enter. They enter however they enter.
Everything enters how they would.
So interesting enough with the tokens, if you have enough tokens, like, for, mind you, Magical Christmas Land, if you do that and you have 100 tokens out and you literally get your whole deck, you're getting all your lands untapped.
Yeah, that's pretty
so
good.
So whatever's in your hand,
that's pretty good,
like,
stuff.
I got 34 lands.
Cool. I just paid 8 mana to tutor out 37 lands onto the field. That's that's pretty good, in all honesty.
Yeah.
100%. That's not bad though. I like that. That's a funny card to see. So my next card is actually a card that I kind of found out about, like, years ago or whatever, because I didn't know that split second cards existed until like a long while back ago. So the card that I included for my next one is Wipe Away. So Wipe Away is one and double blue, so 3 mana. It's an instant. It has split second, and split second specifically says as long as this spell is on the stack, players can't play spells or activated abilities that aren't mana abilities. And all it says is return target permanent to its owner's hand. So it's a 3 mana, bounce something back to someone's hand. Could be a land, could be a planeswalker, because it doesn't matter. They don't get to respond.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You just do it. Yeah. I think this card gets overlooked because the immediate comparison that a lot of people draw to it is Capsize.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Capsize is the exact same mana cost. It's one and double blue. Does the exact same effect, but it has buyback for 3 mana. So for 3 extra mana, you can put it back in your hand as you cast it and keep doing it. A lot of the decks that I typically see that run Capsize are, like, you know, the ones that can make, like, infinite blue or infinite
decks,
colorless,
right?
Like, combo decks or whatever. This, in my opinion, I think needs to get a little more love, because 9 times out of 10, what is another really good split second card that a lot of people run in most decks?
Croson
Grip. Does almost pretty much the same thing, except it's, you know, Croson Grip's a destroy, this is a bounce.
Mm-hmm.
But for 3 mana, you know, both spells being 3 mana, they both get the job done another way with the same kind of in the moment goal of your opponent does not get to respond when you throw the spell out. So if you have, you know, you see your opponent is playing like Teferi Master of Time, the one that has the, I think it's like a negative 10 or negative 12, take 2 extra turns or whatever.
Yeah, right.
And you see that, you know, on the end of their turn before it gets to your turn, when it gets to your turn, they're like, okay, I'm gonna plus up Teferi again. Huh? When it gets to next person's turn, I'll be able to ult him. You'll be like, no.
Right.
Put him back in your hand. Me specifically, I have, ever since I found out about the split second cards, I have absolutely fallen in love with their versatility. They 9 times out of 10 are super useful, and in only very, very specific circumstances, looking at you, Kadena decks, you can't usually do anything about them. So 9 times out of 10, they get the job done for whatever you're trying to do with them in that moment.
For those that don't understand, Morph can go around split second.
Yes, it can.
There's actually a lot of stuff that can go around split second, technically, but maybe that's another video.
Yeah, we can talk about that in another one. But so I think Wipe Away needs to be shown, like, I guess a little more love. People immediately overlook it. They're like, oh, well, Capsize is way better. I can keep recasting it over and over and over again. It's like, okay, cool. But in the moment, right here, right now, I don't want my opponent to do anything.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing. Not a single thing about what I'm trying to bounce back to their hand. Wipe Away says, hey, bro, I got you. Let me take care of it. Hold up. Let him cook.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's my second pick. I just think, me personally, like I said, I'm so in love with split second cards. They are great.
That's fair.
What you got, Holmes?
My second card is one of my favorite ramp cards of all time. I will say all 3 of these cards are in my Jetmir deck. So if you get the idea with that. Interesting. So this is, it's called Druid's Repository. It is a 3-mana enchantment. Correct. Whenever a creature you control attacks, put a charge counter on Druid's Repository. There you go.
Slow down.
Remove a charge counter from Druid's Repository. Add 1 mana of any color to your mana pool.
Mm,
so okay.
There it is.
I didn't know the card existed.
Mm-hmm.
Again, never seen you play it.
Bro, I've played this multiple times.
I don't know.
I think so. I think there's only one time I've ever seen that card played, and it was way, way forever ago.
Bro,
in somebody's
Izuri
deck. The you know, the blue green Claw of Progress Izuri.
Oh man,
I saw somebody run it in that deck.
Okay,
but otherwise, that's the only time.
So okay, so obviously in tokens.
Oh, yeah.
Fantastic.
Yeah,
yeah. Just what you just swing as soon as it comes out of your turn. You're just like, okay, I have like, I don't know, 40 mana to play with. Well, however much you have. Or, like he was saying with like Azuri or whatever, really good in proliferate decks because all you have to do is attack once and be just like, okay, proliferate, whatever. Use whatever you have to.
Yeah, Atraxa, easily.
Wonderful.
Easily.
Yeah, just it definitely rewards you being aggressive. And also, it rewards you for going wide as well because.
Sure.
The more you get, the more you just...
It is super cool. And it's you remove one and you add 1 mana of any color?
Any color, yeah.
It's just...
Yeah.
That's good.
That's pretty good.
Again, never seen him play it, but maybe we'll get him
How many times have you played against my Dremir deck?
Like, honestly, I don't think any times, or at least not many.
I have a couple times.
Yeah. I think I've only played against your Jetmir deck once, and I don't think I watched you play.
I played against
game.
Jetmir twice. I know that for sure, because I was like, let me see how fast, if it keeps up with Zada.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. That's not bad though. And that's a pretty good, pretty decent ramp card.
To be fair,
you'll see it eventually.
Eventually.
When I did play against it the second time, you got mana screwed, and I just ran over your Zada.
That makes sense.
That's fair.
I didn't
That'll
get to
happen.
See much of the deck.
Yeah,
but that happens with Zada.
I mean, I'll see it the next time Jetmir swings at my face for 47 damage.
Exactly.
Possibly more.
No, that is super cool.
That is a cool card. I like that.
Like that really needs to go in like any like green deck that has like.
Any creatures that attack.
I would say like any, almost every green deck is.
Oh my gosh! Like you put that in Najeela.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like that is just disgusting.
And then you already.
Oh
just
god!
Win.
Yeah, that's just fodder for Najeela's ability.
You don't even have to Cryptothrite tap. You just
exactly.
Now, mind you, for that the ones that come in tap and attacking don't trigger it.
Right.
But if you do five, you just win at that point. I don't know about win, but like you get.
You pretty much win.
Basically infinite.
Yeah, you pretty much win.
So
that's just so good.
That's so spicy. I love that.
All right. Mine is a lot less spicy, I think. But it's, again, I think it should be a green staple because green needs more draw.
Oh, yeah. Like,
what are we running? Harmonize? 4 mana?
Harmonize,
draw 3 cards.
Guys Blessing?
Guys Blessing can draw
what's
one
the
card.
Other one I'm thinking of?
I mean, there's Colossal Majesty, stuff like that. That draws
what's
you
the, what's,
card.
What's the one that, that draws you cards for each creature and then you gain life? It has Ferocious on it. Yeah, Shamanic Revelation. That's another one.
Is the Daruk one? The Return of the Wild Speaker?
Return of the Wild Speaker.
That one's
fantastic. That's a really good
one. But here's a better one, all right? And this is why it's better. It's called Hunter's Insight. 2 and a green. Choose target creature you control. When that creature deals combat damage to a player or planeswalker, this turn, draw that many cards. Okay, so for 3 mana, if you, let's say, my best situation is it's in my Targnar deck.
I was going to say, this card reeks of Targnar.
Yes.
This card reeks of Targnar.
But it's not like Targnar, I'm going to do this when Targnar's at 3,000.
Right.
Like,
right.
I'm looking at like 40 or something. I'm like, okay, Targnar's really big. Boom, draw 40 cards for 3 mana.
Yeah.
Like, show me another card that you can draw 30 cards for 3 mana. Show me another card you can draw 20 cards for 3 mana. Show me another card that you can draw 10 cards for 3 mana.
I'm sure I
it's true.
One.
They're probably sure. there aren't many options out there, but I mean,
I will say like green's card draw is just like slightly less situational than white's.
Right.
I mean that's pretty good. I mean there are quite a few green draw cards out there actually, but it's like but they usually do rely upon like weird conditions, like you know, whenever a creature with certain toughness enters the battlefield,
or a creature with certain power,
right.
Like
a lot of them actually have to do with
dealing damage.
Connecting.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, but that one's cool because it's like you get to choose,
and it's an instant speed too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So as soon as they don't block, you're like, cool. That
okay.
One.
Like, yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
I mean,
that's
like,
kind of neat.
Maybe my 5 isn't getting through. My 3 is. We'll get the 3. We'll get the 3.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And 3 mana to draw 3 cards.
Yeah,
it's a good trade-off.
Yeah, it's about on par. Yeah, that's about par for the most
part.
Or
like if you have something with trample,
right?
You know, you're just like, okay, like it got over, cool.
Like Hydra, like specifically.
Yeah, like most of the Hydras.
Okay, and I'll draw 15.
Yep. Like, I'm going to swing my 10-10 Hydra with Trample. I'll block 6 of it. Cool. I'll draw 4 cards.
Exactly. Like it's still a better... I just think this should be as close to a green staple as possible. There might be some situations I'm like, okay, yeah, probably not.
But. Yeah, because I don't think there's really many green decks that don't want to get in for big damage.
Exactly.
Why would you not want to draw a bunch of cards off like, one big instance of damage?
Right? You have double strike.
Trample. Oh, okay. No, okay. I was just like, I mean, most of them are small.
Because it says bigger, every time it deals combat damage.
That would be dumb.
Yep.
That would be dumb. Double strike means it would trigger twice.
Or I'm thinking you get like, you put this in like a Talamax deck.
Yeah.
You know, double it.
Oh, my God.
Cast two copies, pick two different targets or the same target.
Good.
Exactly.
I mean, you run that in Kalamax with having Kesig Wolf run in it too. It's like, cool, we're going in.
When I looked up how many decks it was in, it was like in 1% of 200,000.
Oh, wow.
So what? Like,
yeah, dude, it's insane. On EDH.
That's a really low number.
Like, I'll look it up right now and I'll read off exactly what it says.
He's got this pulled up on standby.
Go ahead and look it up.
Yeah, let's hear your last card, Zach, while Jason looks up the statistic.
So this one is actually a bit of a, like a, this, the reason this one's number one is because it's a lot more personal to me. When I got started in Magic, like really hardcore, shall we say, my first two planes were Zendikar and Innistrad. Zendikar during the whole like Battle for Zendikar sort of block, and then Innistrad when like Shadows came out.
Yeah.
And I bought a lot of Shadows over Innistrad.
Same.
Me too.
So many drafts.
I bought a box or two of Shadows over Innistrad. I remember that.
I bought a box.
Shout out to Gamers Emporium for how long we were there.
Yeah. Shout out to Gamers.
But I got a bunch of copies of this card. It's Epitaph Golem. It's a 5-mana 3/5 artifact creature. You pay 2 mana, and you put target card from your graveyard on the bottom of your library. I run this in literally every deck I can.
Mm-hmm.
Mostly the decks that I built first, like kind of like the early decks that I built have an Epitaph Golem in them.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason for that is because it's like, I mean, mind you, it's a little steep, 5 mana, sure. But in Commander, that's not terribly hard to get to.
Right. No, not at all.
It's a 3/5, so it's a decent body, you know, a nice little blocker, etc. But the cool thing about it is just like, I love the pay 2 mana, put target card from your graveyard on the bottom. Because like, if somebody kills a creature, and you're not running a deck that has a lot of rare recursion in it to begin with,
mm-hmm.
you can just be like, okay, 2 mana. Put that back on the bottom.
Right.
Put it back on the deck. If you've got a lot of stuff that like searches for creatures, or like, you know, if you're doing like a Cascade deck where you're like flipping permanents,
right?
You know, you'd be like, okay, put it back in the deck. Some point I'll get back to it.
Right.
Yeah.
You know? Or you have like a Teferi's Puzzle Box where you're like cycling through the deck, or you know, or and honestly, even if you just have like, even if you don't really need the card, but you just have the mana, and it's like it goes around and it comes back to the person before you. They're at their end step. You've got the mana. You're just like, 2 mana. Put it back in.
Yeah,
right. It might come up later. I might need it.
Yeah.
You know, to me, it's a very versatile card in what it can do. And some of the decks that it can go in and really be beneficial in, it's up there.
Yeah. There's so many different ways to shuffle your library. So putting it back on the bottom is not like I'm never going to see that card again.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I do want to have a request. If you do make a newer deck, since that is so close to you, you should make a Grenzo deck.
Oh, Grenzo, you know,
what's
yeah.
funny is I did think about the interaction between those two.
It is
Grenzo,
crazy.
Grenzo is in my combo deck. Or not chaos deck.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that works out.
Deck.
Yeah. No, that definitely.
It's just so good.
It does really work well. Really,
the black
really
red Grenzo good. Loves a card like Epitaph Golem. Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm just going to slide this on the bottom. Oh,
hey, and oh, look what I got.
High pay X. Oh, that's crazy. How did that get there?
Wow, that's crazy.
I never
right? Oh, that's crazy. How did I get this Inferno Titan out on the battlefield already? Whoa, wild.
So before we move on to Nick, real quick, just to give you guys the stats.
Okay, yeah, let's hear it. I want to hear about the
Return of the Wild Speaker, right?
Uh-huh.
It's in 15% of a million decks.
15%?
Yeah, which comes out to 158,000 decks.
Jesus.
That's insane. Okay.
Okay. Shamanic Revelation, 12%, which comes out to 123,000.
Right.
And
okay.
Good old Hunter's Insight comes into 4%. It's only in 43,000 decks.
Wow.
Out of a million? That is insane.
Out of a million? That's actually... Whoa.
So... people are sleeping on that card and definitely should get their eyes fixed.
Yeah, I don't understand. That's, go man.
Get glasses.
Go get glasses.
I said what I said.
So, for my number one pick, this is me personally, my number one, because I just found out about this card recently, which is funny because it's an old card.
Wasn't I there when you bought it from that store?
Yes. Yeah. You were there when I bought it. So this is an older card. It kind of holds a special place for me because I run it in my CDC deck, which is, you know, as you guys know, it's my mill slash self mill deck. Mm-hmm. When I was originally putting the deck together after I already put it and I was making upgrades to the deck, I was just like, man, like, what are some good, like, what are some not just good, but interesting mana rocks that you can put in a CDC deck? Because, you know, obviously you have, like, your Golgari Signet, your right. Simic Signet, yada yada. We've seen the Signets, kind of lame. When I found this card, I was like, yo, that's cool. And it kind of goes along with what I'm already doing with CDC. So The card that I found is Charmed Pendant. Pendant is a 4-mana artifact, and it has the ability tap, put the top card of your library into your graveyard. For each colored mana symbol in that card's mana cost, add 1 mana of that color to your mana pool. So it gives you a line of text as an example. It says, for example, if that card's mana cost is 3, 2 blue and a black, you would add 2 blue and a black to your mana pool. So it's a card that generates you more mana the more mana pips there are in the casting cost.
Right.
Good example was, and it was kind of interesting because at the time that I did it, I had tapped it, milled the top card. My top card was Memory Plunder, which, as you know, is 4 Dimir mana.
Yeah.
So I add 4 in any combination of blue or black to my mana pool. It's kind of whatever I need. A 4 mana rock that in some of the best case scenarios generates you 4 or 5 mana pips, depending on how many you're running in the cards.
Yeah.
Most people look at mana rocks and they're like, okay, I want it to make at least 1 or 2 mana if it costs 2 or 3. The one that people usually think of is Thran Dynamo. Thran Dynamo for 4 makes 3 colorless.
Yep.
This, to my opinion, sits around that same point of versatility. It kind of sits around almost in that same hovering slot of how useful Thran Dynamo is. Yeah. And because in the case of CDC being a bit of a self-mill, you typically want cards hitting your graveyard. In CDC's case, you want creature cards hitting your graveyard, but a 4-mana mana rock making 4 mana in some of the best case, pretty good.
I will say that maybe the part of the hesitation is that card could whiff.
Oh, 100%.
Yeah. If you mill a land, it's just like...
It's like, ah, cool, I'm making nothing.
You tap it, Sol Ring.
Yeah, what I think of is something similar, too, of like the chances of you getting those pips that you need at the time that you need them, it could be detrimental.
It's not, what's the word? Consistent.
It's not consistent, yeah.
But it is really cool.
It's
but
cool.
Yeah, it
feels
is cool.
Really good whenever you when you mill a Progenitus with that.
You flip it off the top. Oh, there's the Conflux. Let's go.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like, let's go, baby. Like, yeah.
Three ultimatum kind of stuff.
Yeah. Any of that kind of stuff.
Which is also really cool about that, too, because in CDC, I do run Eerie Ultimatum.
As you should.
Yeah. So, obviously, that would be, like, the best case scenario. Oh, cool. Yeah. I just tapped my mana rock, and I made 7 mana with it. Like,
exactly.
Pretty good. But even in some of the other scenarios, it's really not that different from some of the other mana rocks.
Yeah.
In the case of, say, like, with Arcane Signet, sure, it costs twice as much as Arcane Signet does. You're still kind of really getting the same effect. Sure. Worst case scenario, you only hit a card with 1 mana pip and it's cost. Okay. You make 1 mana.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But there is still that problem of, like, oh, you hit a land or you hit a colorless card, then it doesn't really do anything at that point.
But I would say, like you said, the benefit of it is that when you are playing a mill deck,
right,
it just fits the theme.
Yeah, it's very on par for the theme. It's ever since I discovered the card. I think I discovered this card like a year ago, or like a year and a half ago, or whatever. And I was like, "Yo, that's cool," and it kind of fits for what CDC's doing anyway.
Right.
I haven't had a whiff with it yet. Fingers crossed. But it's gonna happen.
The next
I just
three
know
times
it's gonna happen.
It, just land. Yeah.
The next three times is gonna be like, swamp, Bajuka Bog, cool. I just you know what? Blow it up, please. I'm done with it. I'm just over it.
I'm gonna Vandal Blast my own.
I got red in this deck somehow so I can kill my own artifact.
Drop the Eldrazi with the Koala's pips in it. Like, does that even count?
Does that count? But yeah, it's a cool little nifty card. I definitely think I would like for it to get a bit more love, but I also understand there are definitely better options out there. It's just kind of something to put
it.
Something to put in people's radar for when they're building that self-mill deck. Be like, oh, hey, That'd be cool. It's also not that expensive. I think I only paid like, I think I only paid like 85 cents or something less than that for the card. So it's pretty inexpensive for the most part.
Yeah, that's solid.
My last card is, so once again, as most of these guys, I don't think I've ever seen this card played other than by me. And I've been playing for a very long time. Like in
he says,
no. So he says, one 100%. I have played this multiple times. Like I know I played it with multiple people.
No, I've seen this card. But I know I've seen this card before.
Yes, it was in my humans deck.
Did you though?
It caught me off guard because I was like, it does what?
So it's like Crater Hoof's like the wish variant of Crater Hoof a little bit.
we got Crater Hoof at home.
So yeah, basically
we got Crater Hoof on Wish. Go look it up.
So. The creature's name is Martin Stromgold, which is a 4-mana 1/1.
You have to pronounce it just like that.
You have to. It's just the law. It is a human. Mind you, it's a 4-mana 1/1, so I was like, okay, that's kind of meh. But it says, if Martin Stromgold attacks, all other attacking creatures get +X/+X until end of turn, where X is equal to the number of other attacking creatures. And that's just like, okay, that's literally just Crater Hoof on an attacking creature.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Okay. But that's not it. It also says if Martin Stromgold blocks, all other blocking creatures get +X/+X, where X is the amount of blocking creatures.
So it's a blocking Crater Hoof, too.
It's both.
Yeah.
It does both.
It's both of them.
It's both.
So,
it's insane.
Both.
And mind you, in this, once again, in Jetmir, this gets disgusting whenever you're swinging with. Let's say 10 costs. Huh?
Sorry, I'm curious what he costs.
Oh, he's like he's fluctuated. Like whenever I got one of them, he's like 25. Now he's like at 15 or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah, he's more expensive because he's I believe he's reserve list.
It makes sense.
I was gonna say it has to be like a exclusive card.
There you go, $11.
Okay.
But yeah, with Jetmir, because he gives trample and double strike and vigilance. It's just like cool. I'm going to go ahead and swing out with 10 creatures, including him. And then it's just like, oh, they all get +10/+10. Also +3/+0 and vigilance and trample. And it's just like, and you're dead.
It's like, wow, I only counted 10 creatures on the board. Why am I taking 79 damage? Mm-hmm. Like,
and it's just good. Like in my goblin deck, it's great. Like, mind you, this is a very token centric deck, but like you could also just play this in anything with a lot of creatures or a lot of very attacky.
Any beatdown deck, you know.
Any kind of beatdown or go wide Mardu deck loves that. That's,
right.
That's good. Yeah.
I got that. When I got my extra, because I first got my first copy when I was building actually my traded silver deck back in the day.
Hmm.
And the second time I got it was with Isshin, because it says whenever it attacks. Isshin says you double attack triggers.
That's disgusting.
So
that's gross.
Yes, and I did get that off because there was one game I was playing with Matt and Brandon, I think, and I literally had this whole thing with the Mardu Ascendancy, making a whole bunch of goblins, and just kept on swinging with the Krenko, the one where you attack, you make
Kingpin.
The...
Oh, yeah, 10 Street Kingpin. Yeah. Okay.
So I was constantly making them, then I dropped him, and they're just like, okay. It's just like...
Well, that's enough for me.
Yep. Yeah. So I love him. I just can't believe I haven't seen anyone play it.
Yeah.
And that's when Austin sits there and goes, okay, and I'm going to deal, and the person they're swinging at, it's like, you know what? Don't bother with the math. It already... You told me +16/+16. I'm good. I'm not going to put the numbers together. I have 40 exactly. life. We're just... We can call it there.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's cool. I like that.
All right, I'm ready. Oh. You guys ready for your mind to be blown?
1 second.
All right.
Aurelia.
Oh, that would be so stupid.
I don't, I don't get your first combat. I'll get your second.
Yeah.
That's annoying.
I didn't get through on the first one.
I'll get through on the second.
Because that anthem effect lasts until the end of turn?
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
That's annoying. That's so dumb. I hate that.
I just have to point that out. That's
you're right. That's dumb.
That, ooh. I like that.
Yeah. Targnar?
It'd be cool though.
No, Targnar's very like there's not a whole lot of creatures. I guess he's Targnar. Yeah,
that's true. Yeah,
Targnar gets through.
Any deck you put Crater Hoof in, easily.
Yeah,
yeah. Especially if you have the capability for red in the deck too. Yeah, 100%.
All right, are you ready for your minds to be blown?
No,
I'm ready.
No.
All right, my last card. Sit down. Is Mesmeric Orb. All right. So 2-mana artifact. It says whenever a permanent becomes untapped, that permanent's controller mills a card. So all of your lands, everything that you untap, each untap step has you mill a card.
Right.
So generally, if you play this, you're milling 2 cards right off the bat just for playing it.
Right.
More than likely. So it hurts you as well. No big deal. Here's why I think it's the most overlooked. I think it's one of the most equalizer cards to like be played in Commander.
Mm-hmm.
And as if you're playing a mill deck, this should automatically go in.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, now that all that isn't super mind blowing, right? Because that's Mesmeric Orb. The mind blowing thing is it's in 1% of 2 million decks. It is in 27,000 decks.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's funny because I think for a while Mesmeric Orb was a stack staple piece.
Oh, it was,
and then I think over time when we started getting more, like I guess what you would call better stack pieces, are they? Like, I guess the newer cards that came out, people were looking at it and were like, "That's better," and they just kind of cut Mesmeric Orb out.
For two mana, you're like, okay, every time you tap a land, you mill a card.
Yeah.
I would say the difficulty in it is that it hurts you.
Yeah.
Which a lot of people, generally speaking, probably don't want.
But, okay, you know? Going to like Nick's self-mill, this is perfect for that.
Right.
Yeah.
If you're playing anything with the... If you're a good Magic player, your graveyard should be the extension of your hand.
Yeah.
You should be able to make do, and especially with almost every card that was mentioned, two specifically, Gaia's Blessing... If Gaia's Blessing gets milled out, you just put it
back in.
Yeah.
Gaia's Blessing is in my CDC deck.
No big deal. I think Mesmeric Orb, to me, is so close to like an all-around staple. Like, it could go into any deck and function pretty well.
Yeah, but I think there also has to be the understanding of, like, if you're going to put that card in your deck, you kind of want to play around it a little bit because it could end up hurting you pretty badly.
And again, it's not that I think it should be in every deck, but I think it's very close. It shouldn't be in just 1%.
Well, I'll grant you this. I'll push back here. It's an interesting control card.
Sure.
Because I mean, it reminds me of like other cards, like oh gosh.
It kind of reminds me a little bit of Altar of the Brood.
Well, no, it reminds me of that one card where it's like when you cast a spell, you had to bounce a land back to your hand.
Oh,
God, I know a card. Yeah, I know it. I forget Cauldron? Too. Something like
something,
that, yeah.
Something, I don't remember the name of
it's
it.
Like, it's Mana a card. Breach?
Mana Breach.
Yeah, Mana Breach. Yeah. It's a card that punishes you.
Yeah, it's that sort of like, oh, you wanna play cards? Okay. But there's a cost, you know?
Yeah,
like,
so, right.
But I feel like outside of control-y kind of decks, and outside of like self-mill or mill in general, I don't think you'd run that. I mean, you could, and like you're saying, you could easily build around it and stuff like that, but I think, generally speaking, like you wouldn't run that in like a token swing out deck.
Absolutely not. I would not look at that card.
Because then, like, you know, you're like, okay, I'm going to tap everything to like create a bunch of, you know, 1/1s.
Yeah.
And I'm going to get rid of all my staples.
Yeah.
It's not in every single deck, but in any deck that you're trying to control
control pace.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Controlling pace, like... I could see this being pretty good in Archelos.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're kind of keeping that pace and not like, okay, hey, everybody's milling cards or nobody's milling cards
Interesting concept too. Because everything, if everything comes in tapped,
yeah,
you're
exactly.
forcing them to mill more stuff. Yeah, that's funny. I was going to say it's at times it can be a bit of a niche card because like, you know, CDC, you know, mono black Sir Conrad mill decks, like they learn blue black Lazav decks. Look at that. And they go, hey, I like that.
Yeah.
Start dumping stuff in the graveyard, bud. Deck, I mean, yeah. Right.
There's definitely a lot of applications to it. I just say that it's for a certain kind of deck.
Sure.
But yeah. I mean, it definitely should go in those
decks. I kind of like what Zach was saying. Like, I don't think it can go in every deck, but yeah. I think definitely, obviously, mill deck should pretty much be running it. But yeah. I think there are certain control decks that could get a use out of Mesmeric Orb and be like, hey, you want to do stuff on my turn? Cool. Suffer.
Yeah. Oh, what's that one? Doesn't Winter Orb?
Winter Orb says that you can only untap two lands.
That's the opposite.
It's kind of opposite, yeah. And that's also why Winter Orb is like a stack staple.
Yeah, and Mesmeric Orb is $3, and like it used to be like 15, and it most recently went down
I had one of the original. I think the one from Mirrodin.
Yeah, Mirrodin.
I had the lightly played one, and I sold it way back when for like $11, and it was a lightly played one. Yeah. I think that was before it started getting reprinted more often, but it's good.
I just thought about that. Like, it'd be kind of a very like weird niche kind of workaround.
Mm-hmm.
But you play a deck where you like bounce stuff because those things don't untap. Yeah. They just re-enter the battlefield.
Right.
Yeah.
So it's like, say a Brago deck, for example.
Yeah.
You swing, right? Connect, bounce everything out, bring everything back in.
You're good.
Right, exactly. Yeah,
all my stuff's untapped. What about you?
Kind of blink deck, you're just like, okay.
Or not, I guess not all, but it's like most of my stuff's untapped. What about you?
Or like a treasures focus deck because your mana is all from there, so you're not worrying about tapping land.
Oh, yeah. That's true, yeah.
Again, there's so many things that this deck
Yeah, I think there's definitely
It shouldn't be in only 1%. Like, it's a colorless card. It can go into any deck, and it's only in 1%, which is stupid.
Yeah.
So definitely one of the most overlooked, in my opinion.
Oh, yeah. No, I think so, too.
So for the most part. You were saying, like, having people untap stuff, right?
Yeah.
And for some reason, this came into my mind. I know this isn't the best idea to do, but Awakening, which is a 4-mana enchantment.
Oh, my God.
At the beginning of each player's upkeep, untap all creatures and lands. So if you're forcing people to tap all their stuff, and then just whoop.
Congratulations. For 6 mana, you've made a turbo mill.
Yes.
Yeah. Another thing you could do with your blue-white tap deck.
Mm-hmm.
You're just like, cool.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, force tap all their stuff down. And
yeah.
Okay, bye.
Oh, yeah. Worst toll? Oh, my God.
That would suck.
Do you want to tap 1 mana? Gotta tap it all.
Yeah.
Do you want to swing one thing? Gotta swing it all.
Again, that would suck.
Mesmeric Orb is good, and it's only in 1%, and it's that's
yeah,
stupid.
I think that's very strange. It's only in 1% of decks, considering how openly versatile it can be with certain other card matchups.
I'm that guy putting it at 27,000 decks.
I still have a Mesmeric Orb from Double Masters, from the first Double Masters set.
I have one from Mirrodin.
I'm thinking I might just put that in Sidisi now.
I have one from Mirrodin, one from Double Masters, and one from Retro Frame, one from Brothers War.
For that Mograthal, you know?
Would you like to take a guess how many, what percent Martin Stromgold is put in decks? I'll give you a hint. It's zero. It's literally zero.
That's nice. Awesome.
Right here. Literally zero. It's put in 2,781 decks out of a million.
Jesus.
That is insane to me.
That's wild.
It's not actually zero. Let's just get that right for our mathematicians.
Well, sorry, it's like yeah, 0.
It's
point
probably,
whatever.
It's less than 1%.
It's probably like 0.4. Yeah.
0.02 or something like that.
Yeah, it's like 0.02, anything like that or whatever. It's probably something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, yeah. Really awesome picks. We'd love to hear what your guys' picks are. Like, what are your underrepresented, underplayed cards in Magic the Gathering?
Yeah, what are your underdog cards?
Your pet cards.
What are cards that only you like?
No, it's pet. What don't look at me like that.
I don't know about that.
What are your hipster cards?
What are your
hipster cards?
Yeah.
What's your Targnar?
Yeah, what's... okay.
What is your Martin Stromgold?
Yeah, where
show
are your
Mesmeric Orb.
Yeah, where are your Mesmeric Orbs? Where are your Martin Stromgolds, your Charm Pendants, your Warp Worlds? There's a green one. It's, I would say, just as good.
Greater Aurora,
right?
The Great
Aurora. Oh, man. That one's also a good one.
It's
for one mana more.
Deck. Yidris, Warp World, we'll feature our Chaos decks one
yeah,
day.
Yeah, later, a later date.
Yeah, Chaos teams, yeah.
Anyways, we appreciate you watching. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Goodbye.
I did that exact same thing in a different recording. I know.
That should be our new theme.
No, that's the E.T. theme. No, not E.T. Entertainment Tonight.
That
is E.T.
Yeah.
It is E.T. Oh my God.
And Steven Spielberg's birthday is 50.
Oh, no.
We're keeping us in for bloopers, right?
Yeah, we have to.
Oh,
please.
My God.
All right.
We're coming at you live from Velvet Game Studios here with Zach, who just won the Commander Championship. What do you got to say, Zach?
Well, I'll tell you what. I'm going to like, comment, and subscribe.
And then what?
And then I'm going to go on the Discord, the Patreon, and myvelvetgames.com.
We have a website?
We have a website. And you know what else? I'll see you this summer at Summer Smash. You better be there, brother.
Thank you, sir.